Guten Afternoon. I don't say how to say in Deutsch, but I am here and I'm really happy to stay here and to talk about the story of the Abadía project. First, let me introduce myself. How many of you are blood type 0 negative? Oh, great. Last summer I was almost died 5 times and need some blood, and now don't be too far on me, okay? It will not happen, nothing. But it's okay. I am the chief visionary officer at Singular. Singular is a very funny company, and this position is amazing because I am trying to discover what will happen in the future, you know? So it's not too easy, but in the last 5 years, I just did my job, okay? So I am trying to not discover what is the future, just trying to define it, okay? So also in GDE, we'll develop an expert. This is an honorific title. I'm not being paid by Google, okay? So they tell that I am an expert for cloud and machine learning, and I am so happy to think that I am. And I also the Abadía project cheerleader. At the beginning here, I had some things like team leader, machine learning programmer or whatever, but at the end I think the best title is cheerleader. Okay? So also I wrote a book about free software 20 years ago, the first one in Spanish, and I'm also the former president of Hispalinux, the most important and influential local user group, Linux user group, okay? So I am also organizing the Machine Learning Spain and GDG Cloud Madrid. Okay, so let's start. What we'll see. This is very important because when I started to giving this talk 1 year ago, I wanted to talk all I know about reinforcement learning, a lot of things, but at the end, I think the more important thing is that when you start in a machine learning project, you start in a journey, and this journey is so different that you think that will be, okay? And I am telling that because when you go to a talk about whatever from this mind, and they are telling you that they solve the Go game, okay? They just put the last slide of the journey. That in that slide, they have a very amazing artificial intelligence that play and win the game. But for the rest of the mortal, every time you start in a machine learning project, you have a long journey and you need to take a lot of things in consideration. How many of you have active machine learning project now and start from the beginning? Nobody? Okay, perfect. You? Okay. You can be a volunteer for this project if you want it. I don't put too much pressure on you, but I remember your face. Okay, so how the Abadía started. This is amazing because almost in my life happened around beers, you know? So, another guys are working, reading, or in a library, but no. In my case, it's around beers. Okay, so I was drinking some beer with my buddy Sebas, and he told me, hey, you are talking all the time about artificial intelligence, but blah, 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 you get a lot of talk and so on, but why you not starting a project to make something real, more real, and try to solve the idea of crime? And I save a lot of time, no. Okay, because I am not so smart, and I am a little lazy, whatever. But Sunday, I think I had more beers than I think. So I say, yes, I will do it. And we started the project. Well, perhaps it's not the more glamorous way to do that, but that was the beginning. The game. How many of you know the book or the movie In the Name of the Rose? Oh, perfect. Yes, perfect. I will not make different from millennial or not, because millennial see movies and the rest of the people read books or not, but it's okay. And how many of you know the game, David Kine? Wow. Two in a row, eh? Perfect. This game was amazing because was there is a lot of legend about this game, but the first one is from 1987. It's the first game in 3D, pseudo 3D, okay? This is important because we are talking more than 30 years ago with computer like the Spectrum, you know? It was a really crazy thing. So, the size of the program is 87 kilobytes, okay? And that includes all the graphic, all the code, all the music, map, very complex map, because the abbey has 3 floors, a labyrinth. It's not easy to do that. And I tell you that because this program is amazing. If you see the original code, you will discover all the tricks you need to make wonderful programs in just only 87 kilobytes, okay? 87 kilobytes is so small that when you send one avatar in your WhatsApp or in your Telegram or whatever, it's more like the size of the avatar is something like 80 avatars. I tried to find one avatar, and I find this wonderful picture from me when I was young. No, so young, but I was in another episode of my life before machine learning. And this is the same size of the program. So what is the team? This is the team, 2 person. Now when you try to do a computer game, you need 200, 300 persons team. Okay, there is a artist director, the guy that designed the hair of the second character, you know. There is a crazy thing. But at this time, there was one programmer, Paco Menéndez, and one artist graphic that was Juan Del Can. Okay, so that was the team. So what's the plan? Because it's very important to have a plan, because you know, if you drink a lot and starting very fast, you can go whatever. But the plan was to try to make an artificial intelligence that can learn to play or solve the game. I need to spoiler myself because actually we don't solve the game. We are trying to. And you will discover why not solve yet the game, okay? So we started with this assembly code that from the original media, that was an audio tape that we, with an old cassette, we disassembly this. Manuel Abadía comment every line, and we, with this, we starting to try to manage this, okay? So if you want to see the original code, it's in this link, so you can check it. And after that, we port into C++. Okay? Manuel Abadía from the team did it. So after that, we had an executable that can play or that can run in Chrome, in PlayStation 3, and a lot of systems. Okay? So this is the beginning of the project. We have the executable. How difficult is the challenge? What is the... Any of you know what is the number of photons approximately of the universe? It's 10 elevate 80. Okay? There is a little funny thing that the last letter from Stephen Hawking says that there is more than one universe, but this is not important. We can think that only there is one universe. Okay, so what is the number of Lego chess move? 10^120. Okay, it's not this again. Go 10^761 move. And Andavadia, and that's amazing. 10^10,000. This is perfect because if we beat that, we are better than the mind. It's more difficult. It's more amazing to try to solve something like this. Okay? For the people that not go too much to the mathematical class, I put this because it's a very graphical way to discover how difficult it is. Okay? So, the thing is that I don't know, humans and artificial intelligence don't know if the game is over until you play at least 10,000 movements. Okay? That one, this is very important. I don't know any human player that finishes the game without instruction. You got instruction, you can solve it. If not, you are skewed. Okay? So, there is a lot of or little things that make this game so difficult to solve. When you are playing chess or playing Go, you don't need to fight with the rest of the character. In the case of the Abadía, all the time the bat, Asso, and even another monk is all the time trying to block me. So the artificial intelligence is not only to know how need to do, need to know how to avoid this kind of heavy traffic situation. Okay. Also, there is a lot of trap into the game. When every day at the vísperas hour, ring the bells, and you need to leave whatever you're doing and go very fast to the chapel to listen in the offices. You don't that, just die. If you don't put in the right position of the chapel, you die. If you don't look the eyes of the abad, you die. So the artificial intelligence needs to learn a lot of things. Just listening, just need to know how to go to the chapel, lots of things. Even that happens when it's the sexta hour, that is when they have the dinner and need to go to this room and sitting in the right position. Okay? So even, well, this is a blurry picture because all the time I said I will change it, but I never did. And I never find one better. But in this case, the guy from the library keep one key over the table, and you need to put Asso in front of this monk to try to stall the key. And that's need to be learning for the artificial intelligence. Okay? I just only telling that because it's not easy to solve this game. So, what is the first step when you have a project like this? And even another project in real life. The first things you need to do is interacting with the game, get a lot of information. That means playing games and playing a lot to try to learn something. So what is the way to communicate with this C++ game, this old game? At the beginning, and with a lot of peer, we think that was the best idea, to put an old computer with a robotic car, with a camera, with some, in this case, an NVIDIA JSON, a couplet, and try to send the movement, get the information, and send to the artificial intelligence. But you know, this is over-engineering. I say that because all the time in my project, we over-engineering. So the first lesson is, please don't over-engineering. I'm pretty sure all the time there is more easy ways to solve the thing. Okay, so this is funny because we try to do that. Okay, so what is the best way to do that? We started in trying to use a fake keyboard, a unit pipe. I love the unit pipe, but at the end, I'm pretty sure you are talking all the time in the last 10 years about the way we did it. An embedded server. This is absolutely genius. You put a server inside the game, and after that you had an API. Come on. I'm pretty sure you tell to your customer all the time you need an API or two, because sometimes the problem is too complex. We can call it microservices or whatever basis. You put one server embedded into the game, and after that you have an API and you are the champion of whatever. Okay, so I'm really happy and very proud of this, because that was an idea from mine. So now I have an API, so I can send action to the game, I can get information, I can make a lot of things, so I can start trying to interacting with the game. Okay? Just as easy like this, I can move the Guillermo, I can get all the information from the game. And usually I did a kind of demo like this, that I start a game, I send one command to just rotate the Guillermo, and this is very effective. I remember 1 year ago in London, I did this demo, and the people standing make a big ovation, like it was something really, really amazing. But I will not do it here because you are tired. It's almost the last tour, you know, but believe me, this is amazing. The first time I did that, and the Guillermo said, and rotate, I said, wow, this is a little step in the artificial intelligence, but so amazing for me. Okay, so I will show you much more things. So that's very important, and nobody tells you about this when you are starting an artificial intelligence. You need to get all the information you can. Okay, so every time we play a game with the artificial intelligence agent against the game, we get a JSON, of course JSON, forget something like YARM, that is somebody here love YARM, YARM format, okay. I think it's worse than ELF and ELF, but it's okay, JSON is perfect for the human eyes, okay. So we got the game information, we got all the action we play into the game, we get sunset point. Even we set the retraining model we're using during this game. And this is important because you need to do a lot of analysis, okay? If you play millions of the game, imagine you solve the game in the first week. You need to understand what happened. You need to make replay or understand what happened all the time. So you need to save all the information you can. Okay? And the good news is that we can save all the information we wish, because almost today, at this moment, you can store whatever with a reasonable price. Okay? There is one important point here, the first file, point, because one of the options of the game was to save one state of the game. Imagine you cross a room and you want to save the state and recover after. We use this because We don't need to start from the beginning of the game all the time. We can recover, save and recover a lot of states, and actually we have 20 million checkpoints or whatever, and almost 1 terabyte of information. Okay, so that takes a lot of time. I am pretty sure you hear about that the process in a machine learning project or a big data project, 90% of the time is just gathering information, cleaning, processing that is real and it's worse. In the case of Abadia, we almost now we have a 99% of the time just plumbering data, making scripts, automating things, just checking that work. I remember the first million of games project was saved, and when I tried to read this 1 million file, was corrupted because I forgot something in JSON, you know. And I said, wow, I cannot believe it. I spent 1 month playing games, and now I cannot read this. Okay, that's happened. That's happened. I need just 2 minutes to repair the 1 million files. But the lesson here is you need to save a lot of information, checking a lot of things, because if not, you will be screwed. By the way, how many of you know why Mario carry this funny cap? Oh. It's a very good history. It's about the programmer that make the animation of Mario, okay, need to make the animation of the hair. And say, this is so difficult, so I will put a cap. And this solves the problem. This is another free lesson from today. If you need to have an MVP, put a cap. That is the problem, put a cap. And because at the end, you had the game working, and you had your first prototype, and it's only to put a cap, and it's a funny thing. Now, Mario without the cap is nothing. Okay, so how organize this? Believe me, the first time I sent a command to the game engine and with the embedded server with my wonderful and amazing API, I was tempted to starting to make my very first artificial intelligence. So I will start insane, I will start whatever, you know, this kind of... I was so excited, but I stopped 1 second and discovered that there is a thing called OpenAI Genes. Do you know what is OpenAI? Okay, it's a project from Elon Musk. You know, this guy make a space rocket, boring tunnel, car, whatever, and has an artificial intelligence foundation because he's worried about the artificial intelligence. So, well, he puts a lot of money, and the guys are playing all the time all games and all these things. Okay, and one of the projects is to try to normalize what is the way to do reinforcement learning. Okay, when you are and they invented or normalized it, a thing that is a gym. When you have a game, you are not playing against the game, is or trying to experiment with reinforcement learning. You design a gene, and all the genes have the same way to work. You have a reset, you have a new game, you have give me what is the next action. I want to make this action, just rotate or go ahead or whatever. Give me what is the next state and what is the reward. Okay, this is are very common or almost all the reinforcement learning problem. So with the OpenAI, you have normalized this. So 1 week after, we have an Abadia OpenAI gene. Okay, so you can. There is a link in the down part of this slide. But We have a gene, and now whatever that know how the OpenAI genes works can make an agent very fast and trying to work with that idea. This is very important because we had the original game, with C++ version and so on, the API, and now we had the OpenAI gene that is a kind of a universal interface for a reinforcement learning experiment. Okay, so next point, we had the REST server, we had an OpenAI gene, and we had enough hardware resources. This is important because we will need it, but I will explain after a little thing. I will not try to. How many of you know what is reinforcement learning? Perfect. You never see one explanation of what is reinforcement learning so simple and so funny. Yeah? Let me show you with two slides. This slide, 90%, all the time is something like that you have an environment, in my case, the game, or the OpenAI gene, you have the agent, that is the artificial intelligence that are trying to learn, and all the time you decide with whatever strategy that you have one state, and you decide what will be the next action. Okay? So when you have the action sent to the environment and receive the next state, and what is the reward, and with this, you feedback again the agent and store this information and try to make some models to learn. But this is the only thing you need to understand reinforcement learning. It's as easy like an infinite loop trying to understand what is happening. You have more reward, you are doing the things okay. In my case, if you play 10,000 move and solve the game, you have the reward from one, and if you die, you have minus one. Okay? So you see like this. The other important thing, or the best way to define this is with this movie. This movie is reinforcement learning. Yeah. With my beloved Bill Murray, all the time that is the previous loop. He wake up in the morning, starting doing things, starting learning piano, or try to cross the street, but he's pass over a trap over here, or he tried to be loved by the girl, you know, a lot of things. But you all the days starting with the previous learnings that you get this day. This is reinforcement learning. With just only these two things, you know what is the reinforcement learning is. Okay, so I will make a little demo over there because real-time demos doesn't work. Oh, and I will put some energy also. Okay, I think there is not too much contrast. Now I am executing one agent, time two, that is talking with my API. Can you switch off the light? He's trying. Well, there is nothing interesting happened here, but here is Guillermo is receiving. This is a loop I had playing games. I will tell more about this. And in this case, it's been so boring. But sometimes here, almost all the time, I had to screen in my desktop in my office. Okay? And one of these is with playing the game all the time, and another is my real work. I mean, sending emails and all this thing. So I am checking this. Now it's so bored, but you imagine that the main thing is that we start a Docker or whatever with the engine, and one with the game, and playing all the time, studying in Google, and I will show you how that does work. Okay, so how work internally reinforcement learning. There is a lot of strategies to try to define what is the next action. The first one is so easy, it's random. Just try, if I can do 10 movements, go north, go south, or stay in the same place. I can choose this random and try to get what is the next state, or if I got one rewards or no. Okay, that's not work. I put 1 week with this, and obviously don't solve the game and not learning anything. But it was so good to test all the things that it was problem with the communication with the API and start making Kubernetes jobs or all these things. The second thing is to create one Qtable. Qtables are very interesting because for a small problem, you can create a table and say, when you are in this position, the best thing is to go ahead. When you are starting in or you go to this position, the best is rotate to left or whatever. But imagine, if you had 10 options or 10 legal moves and you had 10,000 need to action to solve the game, it's not possible to have this in memory, okay? And it's not possible. The second thing is about, and this is the state we are. Qtable is like a Markov chain. You are updating with the reward what is the best action, okay? But this is almost infinity. Try to do with this game. The second strategy we are using is more interesting because it's the same thing that these main people using in AlphaGo to solve the AlphaGo the Go game, and is to try to not to make a big table with the what is the best action for every position, and remember here is important the day, the hour, the room you are, and the object is in this. So it's not just a one dimension or two dimension table. The thing is to try to discover, to have a deep neural network that solves the game. That when you tell to this neural model, I am in the first day, in the vísperas hour, and the chapter, he say, hey, stay here because you need to stay here until the hour changes. Okay? So this is the really thing about reinforcement learning. How to learn without a lot of tests, what is the best strategy to not die, in my case. When you have more near in time rewards, you can have another kind of stimulus. But in this case, if I did that, don't die, so it's a good thing. So learn about this, because next time I am here trying to play, I will try to use this strategy. Okay? So at the end, my deep neural network is something like this. I called a lot of lines to filter data, to synchronize, process, whatever. But at the end, it's so easy. Like we had a vector with now 75 parameters and a very simple neural network with 24 layer, another layer with 88, And after that, we reduce the thing just to get what is the predicted value of this position. Okay, it's as easy like this. We use Keras. How many of you are using Keras, the framework? Okay, wonderful. And the best framework to do that, because if you try to do that with TensorFlow, you can do, of course, but at the end it's a lot of line more, and this is the code about the real artificial intelligence. I put this because there is only one slide to show this, but there is a lot of things to do. The first thing we did was create container for the game and for the agents, okay? And this is very important because what is the most repeated sentence from programmer? I will tell you and you will smile. That's work in my laptop, okay? So, and that's not happen. So the first thing you need to do is to create a Docker file, because that's work in every place. At the same moment you have Docker, you can run this whatever you wish. And it's so easy. At the end are 20 lines that solve this. The second thing we did, create an smart cluster with Kubernetes. I never write down Kubernetes because it's so funny to put K8S. So it's so smart, because even I had more or less the budgets I wanted in Google, because I am Google developer expert. If I am not doing something with Bitcoin, they put me more resources, so there is no problem with this. But I am trying to give a lesson to the Bitcoin people that spend millions every month. And we had a Kubernetes cluster of just 10 maximum size, 10 machines, and the machine type is N1 standard. N1 standard is almost nothing. It's the more, well, it's not the small, but almost the small machine. The price when it's printed table is 7 euros a month, not every machine. So you can multiply, and now I am spending 35 euros every month. Okay? And I really love it to try to do it in this way, because it's more important to try to do it in a smart way. But now we had the the cluster, all the time, every time I play a game, remember that I generate 4 or more JSON files with information. For me, it's very important to understand that all the time you are doing artificial intelligence, all this time you will need to design pipelines, machine learning pipeline, and you need to try to make this in a professional or industrial way. Okay, so in the case of the information, I am using Cloud Storage and a bucket, but I have a trigger that automatically, when I route down a JSON file with a cloud function, is loaded into BigQuery. I put this example because I try all the time to not make too much coding. I try to not have machines that, what is the last time you need to start one server? This is the question. It's about serverless, to try to do nothing. Do you know what is the best definition of serverless? It's not the Wikipedia one, that is a big definition. It's one from my. How many of you know Italian? Well, I will try to translate. Dolce far niente. That is sweet, do nothing. You need to put this in your mind. serverless is Deutsche Farniente. Try to do nothing and keep the things working. And this is an example. I don't want to have another process that read all the files I wrote and have a virtual machine with Linux or whatever that gets information, process it, and send to BigQuery. Now I can drop 1 million whatever number of files in cloud storage, and Google will provide me with this trigger and enough machine with cloud function to read this file, to clean or aggregate information and insert into the BigQuery. And the price for me is I don't need to do nothing. Remember, Deutsche Farniente. And the price is $3 a million of call, and the first million is for free. So, wow. It's not brainer decision. So take in account this, serverless all the time. Auto gaming. I put this slide in this. This is a new one in this presentation because everybody talk about auto NN, auto parameter. So auto gaming. Okay. And this is the way we organize some flows. In this case, we have a lot of information. The more important for this flow is the checkpoint. So we have a little cell that get the last checkpoint and make a little cell using grep, my beloved grep, in the command cell, and make a selection of 1,000, 5,000 games to replay and send to a queue. Okay? So all the time I had pair of job in Kubernetes, one game server engine, and one agent that picked one of these games, like you see in my laptop, and replay 5 times, 10 times, whatever, this game, save the information in a bucket, and after that, every 2 hours, every 10 hours, whatever, the game generator generates new games with the that are inserted in a queue to fit the rest of the game. I did all the time this with job. I will put over there. Here is the game. Canon. I discovered this little program, SK9S. That is a kind. Oh, here. That is a kind of interface for Kubernetes. So now I have running 3 jobs. One is completed, that is about pre-training. But you see the log. Now I had 3 jobs of Kubernetes, and I can say, show me what are you playing. And as you see, it's playing one of the game I queued into the pass app in Google, okay? So at the end, you need to I think something is wrong. Just a little wrong, but I can stop. Stop work. Very fine. If not, yeah, okay. Yeah. So this is very interesting because all the time you will need to orchestrate things, and Kubernetes is perfect for this. You will need to run version of your program into container, and Docker is perfect for that also. And this is, for me, was a kind of discovery, because before that I don't get the thing about the Kubernetes, because just look like the shares, the bugs or shares I did for Linux 30 years ago. But now I'm so happy to use all the time. Okay, so I use a lot of things. Google BigQuery and it's not about I am a Google developer. It's so wonderful. You can have thousands of millions of actions, and you can make queries without any problem and have an answer in less than 20, 100 seconds. But you imagine you try to start at this and trying to make a complex query. So, and it's cheaper, you doing the right way, it's so cheaper also. Okay. We also are using a lot of notebooks. How many of you are using notebook? For me, it's another revolution. When you try to run some code, at the beginning, try to run in my computer, but at the end, all the day, are you working with, in my case, with Colab, that is a free service from Google, and I have access to GPUs, TPUs, or whatever. You don't need to try to make some configuration and work for very, very, very fast and easy. It's the more easy way to share with the rest of the team all the resources or all the things we are doing. Okay? We are using Keras. Keras is a framework over TensorFlow, and we are so happy with this. My recommendation is if you wanted to do something with deep learning, doing with Keras, because if you need to do something that is not able to do Keras, and there is the 9% of the cases, you can do with TensorFlow. But Keras is so wonderful. The only book I recommend is one from the Keras author, François Chollet, that is deep learning with Python. It's about Keras. But Keras and doing this learning with Keras, and I really recommend you this book. Every paragraph has sense in the book. Okay, I told you about how we orchestrate the things, and of course we have a GitHub, and we are sharing all the thing we are doing every day. In this case, 2 days ago, 5 days ago, but here, there is the gene, Bigasoko SDR is the name of the engine. We have even a front-end to try to manage the information. We are now working also with an API to try to have a pool of game, and everybody in his house who wanted to collaborate get one game, send this to the API. I started working in a disaccoupled way with a pool of games or game engines, and you can run the game from your computer, because you know that's with this you have the feeling you are collaborating, and just join us. We share the glory with you. This is an amazing project. I can say that I learned a lot. And I know I will learn more with this. So I need to share this with this. And if you help us with whatever, you will be in the credit with the same side phone. And we also have a slash, and as you see, sometimes we broke the game. And did you remember Matrix, the first movie, when Agent Smith started replicating himself? And but that happened to us. Was a ghost mode that we don't know how did, but at the end was solved. Okay, and that's all. In this slide, there is a lot of the more important thing is this talk has a free question lifetime warranty. That means if you are so excited to make a question now, you are tired or you wanted to do the answer 1 month ahead, there is no worry. Lifetime means that if I died, no answer. Okay? So we are helping people, and this is my email and my Twitter. All the days I wrote a lot of Twitter, and I think more or less 10 or 15 with very, very interesting links that I don't read. Okay, so the way I work is something like I call collaborative intelligence. Is that I put this link because I think they are very interesting. You read it, you like it, and then I say, oh wow, that must be great because everybody is liking the thing, you know, collaborative intelligence. So you wanted to subscribe my account, that's what you will find. And that's all. Thank you very much. I don't know if you have any question. How many of you will be join the project? Believe me, it was amazing. I get 50 talks in the last year around the world. In my case, you can do, and believe me, I learn a lot of machine learning because it's not the same just reading a lot, viewing it very clear. You need to get the data, you need to spend a lot of time managing data and understanding what happened, because it's not so theoretical. And this project is so funny. Do you have a question? Or Okay. Pues, I will stay around a little because I need to fly to Madrid today, but thank you very much again.